wonderful. Could we give him a round of applause? Just to honor you and welcome you to our home. Here, we always say, Mahalo nui, no koko hele mayane, ka hale puli, ke e kakahi yaka, e kau koko opo mai kai, maluna ne, o ko pakahi a pau, makai no Yesu Christo. Amen. You are blessed. Thank you for joining us this morning as we just worship the Lord in His house. We're so glad to have you. Welcome, welcome, welcome. At this time, can I ask everyone, you should have a program, and in your program, there will be an envelope. And something that we do here is that we write a letter to the Lord. So on our tithe and offering, that's the envelope that I'm referring to. There should be an envelope in there for tithes and offering. And what we want to ask you to do first is just to write God a letter. We teach life journaling here, and what that does is we go through the entire counsel of God's Word, the Old Testament once and the New Testament twice, every single year. So we read through the entire counsel of God's Word every single day. And as we read through the Word of God, we're writing down, what is it, Lord, that you're speaking to me? Lord, because of your Word today, how can I be changed? How can I be transformed? How can I be more like you? And as we do that, then we can start to develop these ears to hear the Lord, and we develop a relationship with God. And that's what we'd like to always encourage every single one of us, to just have this relationship, an authentic, real, genuine relationship with Jesus. And so maybe you don't life journal, but one thing we do want you to do is just write a letter to the Lord on that envelope. And when you put your tithes and offering inside that envelope, it's just a form of worship, saying, Lord, I worship you, and you are who I serve. And so we want to ask you to start doing that. And I do have a quick message this morning in light of our tithes and offering. And you may be familiar with this scripture, maybe not, but it's found in Malachi 3:8 and 9. Can you open that up for me? 3:8 and 9. And it says this. It says, here it is. Will a man rob God? Rawr! Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have you robbed? What way have we robbed you? In tithes and offering. You are cursed with the curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Certain places, we could go to certain places and they'll say stuff like this. If you don't tithe, God is going to curse you. And we want to say, is that really true? Does God want to curse us if we don't tithe? Does God want to put his finger on us and hurt us if we don't give this tithe and offering? And I know for the most part, we know the Lord and we know the truth about this already. But I want to draw your attention now to Galatians 3:13 and the truth to the matter. And it says there that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Last week we talked about the fact that when Jesus Christ died for us, when he died there on the cross, he didn't just take away our sins, but he took away the factory. He took away the manufacturer of these sins. He has taken upon himself everything, every curse, every single piece of death. Jesus Christ has already taken it. So I always like to remind us that when it comes to tithing, it's a form of worship. It's never a form of fear. And so please don't let anybody tell you, if you don't tithe, God is going to curse you. You want God to curse you? You want God to curse you? Because I remember being told that myself, saying, you want God to curse you? And I'm like, no, I don't want God to curse me, you know? And, oh, you better tithe. Oh, I better tithe. And so, you know, and so we start to give out of this heart that's inaccurate. And some people will even teach, you know, we gotta instill a little bit of fear because it keeps everybody straight and it keeps everybody giving so you can operate. And I said, you know what, you can do things however you want to do things, but I'm gonna believe the Bible and I'm gonna stick to it. And so that's why we encourage everybody to tithe, yes, and to give in offerings, sure. But to do that out of a heart that wants to worship, not out of a heart of fear. As a matter of fact, we should look at this word fear. You know, people say fear, fear, fear. The fear of the Lord. We need to have this fear of the Lord. But would you like to know the definition that Jesus gives for fear? Let's take a look at Matthew 4:10. And this is when Satan is tempting Jesus. He's tempting Jesus. And Jesus is using the Word of God to fight back and say, no, this is what the Word of God says. And this is something that Jesus says. Then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Now, in this passage of scripture, Jesus is quoting from the Old Testament. Let's take a look at what Jesus was quoting and how he translates the word fear. So it's found in Deuteronomy 6:13, and this is what it says. You shall fear the Lord your God and serve him, and shall take oaths in his name. So Jesus knew this scripture. He knew that it said to fear the Lord. But when he used it, when Jesus used it, he translates that word to worship, not to fear the Lord, to worship. We believe that there is a fear of the Lord, a reverential kind of fear of the Lord, like a child walking around in a carnival and doesn't know where his daddy's at, like, oh my gosh, where's my daddy at? That kind of fear, that's the kind of fear. We want to have this kind of worship. And we want to be able to serve him only. One more scripture, and it's found in Matthew 6:24, and it says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, or God or money. It has to be one. And that's why the scripture that we just read, to worship the Lord and to serve him only. So that's what we want to do as a church. We want to worship the Lord in our tithes and our offering. And we want to serve him only. Because a lot of times we start to depend on our own jobs and we have to, you know, count our money and make sure that everything's okay. And sure, we want to be good stewards of those things. But we want to put all of our trust in God. We want to put all that we are in God. And when you do that, Matthew 6:33 tells us that everything, all these things will be added onto you. Amen. So at this time, we want to invite some of the worship team that is going to be leading us at this time, Pastor Roy, and your team, as we take this tithe and offering time together. And if you guys want to, and can we pray? Let's pray over this offering, and Pastor Roy and his team, they're going to lead us in a time of worship. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to worship you like this, to give to you these tithes and these offerings, Lord. We know that the moment that we release it from our hand, we are saying that we trust you. We are in new covenant relationship with you under grace and not under the law. So Father, we thank you for this opportunity to even have money to give, this currency that we use right now, Lord, because there may come a time when this currency we may not even be able to use it. But while that we can, Lord, we use everything that we can and we give it to you. And we thank you, Lord. We know that not 10% belongs to you, because 100% of it really is yours. Help us to be good stewards of what we have. We thank you for this opportunity to give, to worship, and to serve. In Jesus' name, amen. Introduce to you our speaker for this morning. His name is Pastor Roy, a great friend of mine. He and I just a fellowship together and out of New Hope, and the Lord has just blessed him so much, given him a revelation of what God wants him to do, and he has had to just follow the pillar of fire, and it hasn't always been easy. Because sometimes it's even Christians too that can shoot some arrows, and it's kind of hard. But he's been very faithful to the Lord and just following the pillar of fire. And we are so proud of what he's doing and so glad to be able to partner with him. Would you help me to just honor our pastor here this morning, Pastor Roy Yamamoto.
It's our heart and prayer that the Holy Spirit will bring down, and as all God's people, we will stand on His word and let His truth be heard. God is so good, man, and I think about today is Father's Day, and what a blessing You know, when I was in prison, and I was able to send a gift out to Angel Tree. When I was locked up and I couldn't give a gift to my daughter. And you know, this church came and I signed my daughter up in this church and came and brought a gift to my daughter. And you know something? That was the first time my daughter had hope that dad was changing. And when I got out from prison, God did this miracle and brought her back in my life after 13 years. And you know what happened? One day I just got custody to take her out on the weekends and I take her surfing this one day. And you know what? My daughter goes out there and she starts surfing. My friend pushes her. We're teaching her. And you know what happens? My friend's board goes in front of her and cuts her leg. And she was bleeding and it was a big cut. And I was so scared and thinking to myself, oh my gosh, you know, they don't take my daughter away again from me, you know. And I was just praying. And you know, when I took my daughter, look at the cut, I felt so much hurt for her that I was carrying my daughter and through the lobby at the Sheraton. And I was carrying her and I was holding her. And the pain that she had, I was feeling it more than her. And you know something, when we were walking through the Sheraton, there's this big fish tank over there and there was this turtle in this first bunch of turtles in this fish tank. And as I'm walking and holding my daughter close to my heart, heart to heart, she said, Dad, you know something? When you were in prison, this church came and brought this gift to me. And you know something, Dad? The gift that they brought to me and they said was upon you, that's when I knew, man, that God was going to change your life. And as she started crying and said, Dad, you know that prison, it meant so much to me. And from that day on, I had a lot of presents, but I cherished this present the most because it was from you. And it meant so much to me. And she said, I still have it to today. It was just a little stuffed animal. But you know, this was presented upon me. But you know what the greatest present was? You know, that she loved me no matter what I went through. And you know what the blessing was so much? It wasn't the gift that was given to her. You know, the stuffed animal. The most precious gift was given to her was that gift, knowing it was from our Father in heaven and that Jesus was going to be in Daddy's life now. That was the precious gift, was Jesus. You know, on this Father's Day, we come and we get to be honor our fathers here today. And such a blessing. It's such a blessing. The Bible talks about us in Ephesians to be imitators of God. And you know something, that's such a blessing. You know, we got such a responsibility as fathers, you know, to be imitators of God, to convey His heart, and to teach our kids up, you know, ways of the Lord. And my son was here dancing in front of me, so I was so emotional, forgive me. But, you know, God blessed me with his son when I got out of prison, and blessed me with a beautiful wife, and blessed me with Afakasi means have some way, you know, have Holly, have some way. It's such a beautiful boy. It's a gift from God to me. And it's so precious. You know, my son, he's so such a blessing to me. And fathers, it's a blessing. The greatest gift that God can give you as parents, mothers, and fathers is to bring them up in the Lord. Because you know something, they will never depart. And I tell you something, for my son, we're just telling him that he's such a spiritual leader, you know, even at a young age. And we're not perfect. Me and my wife so far from perfect. We make so much mistakes and we represent, you know, Lord, not in the best ways always. But you know, God sent this boy to be an angel to us, you know. And it is so unbelievable, you know. I remember the Bible talks about in James to be a doer of the word, not just a hearer. Observing yourself in a mirror, observing yourself and going away from the mirror and forgetting what kind of man you are. And you know, my son, he is such a blessing and he memorized scripture and the Holy Spirit, and because he sees us doing that. You know, he memorized scripture and he comes up and one day he just recites the fruit of the Spirit to me, which is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, above all self-control. And I'm looking at him, how you learn all this, you know? And he, God, you know, just anointed and appointed this young boy at a young age. That's the greatest gift we can get, is bringing up our children in the way of God. And it's going to be a blessing for us. You know, such a blessing. You know, we teach them that scripture, and we were in a restaurant in San Diego one day, and I remember me and my wife having lunch inside there, and my son, you know, he was little, I think he was only like 6 years old, he was so rascal and playing around, and I tell him, stop, and he was being real bad, and I said, I'm going to suss at you, and somewhere that means, you know, lay hands, you know, on him and pray for him. And I remember one day, I said that loud in front of a church, and all the girls from our ministry was coming down. You want some chips with that salsa? But you know something, I remember telling him that, and I said, I'm going to salsa you when we go out of this restaurant, you know, if you don't listen. And he was coming out, and I was playing around with him. Come over here. When he was coming out of the restaurant, the boy went book up the street here and turned around and goes, remember the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, and peace, kindness. You know, I looked at him, had this guy walking up the street, and he looked at us, and he just started rolling and laughing at me, you know, and I said, oh my gosh, you know. Such a blessing that our children can teach us so much if we raise them up in the Lord. And, you know, last week we had this meeting with our junior mentors, the children who dance, and for a leadership team up in a mountain, who was talking about Ephesians, where they talk about, you know, don't let anything bad come out of them, I'll talk about gossip and stuff. And I told them, I addressed them, you know, we gotta pray. And I said, I'm the one that make the biggest mistake in this too, and we all do. But we gotta pray instead of gossip. And you know, teaching them that. And a couple of days later, me and my wife drive in, and we start, oh, my daughter never called us a long time, but we start talking about my daughter. And after that, you know what, we driving like this, and we stop, and in one hand come up in the console like this, you know, we're like, put your hands in mine. We're like, what? We're going to pray. So we put our hands on top of my son's hand, and he started praying, and he said, Lord, help us not to gossip, Lord. Help us, Lord. We pray for Kristen, Lord God, that she would call and come, and Lord, that you just bless her. And me and my wife just got so convicted, and we turned around and said, thank you so much, you know. Thank you so much for being that you know, that wonderful son to us. And we looked at him, and we said, son, you know something? I promise you, me and mom learned more from you than we learned from any other pastor or preacher or anybody else. Thank you for being the young man of God. You know, so fathers, the greatest gift that you can give to your children is really bringing them up in the Lord. And we're going to make mistakes, but go to them and say, repent, Lord. I'm sorry. You know, help daddy to be better and pray with your children. And I tell you something, God will bless you 100-fold. You know, I'm really blessed, and thank God for being here today. Thank Pastor Kippy. Good to see my brothers over here serving alongside Calais. And to see God burning up this new church is such a wonderful blessing. To see my brother, such an anointed man of God, and his heart is so, so awesome. You know, he loved the Lord so much, and it's evident. You know, so thank you, Pastor Kippy. You know, just want to share, I don't know if many of you guys know me, but, you know, life was never very good. See, I had an imitator that I followed in my life, from my dad, and he wasn't the greatest imitator, you know. I raised with a lot of abuse, you know, and because of it, you know, I got hurt a lot, and, you know, to the point where I was put in the hospital for a long period of time because of abuse, and you know, when I went back to school, it was hard for me. I couldn't keep up with the rest of the students, and because of it, I never did kind of learn. I already had a hard time, but I never learned my whole life, and that drove me to drugs, and because of the drugs, you know, it really took full control of my life, you know, took full control of my life, and kind of destroyed myself to hide myself from the pain. I did drugs, and you know, it was so bad because it got to the point where my drug habit became like $1,000 a day, and sometimes more. And I was hooked like for 20 years, and for me to be living today, I know it's only the hand and the grace of God, and I'm grateful to the Father. But you know something, God is such an awesome God that, you know, He loves us so much, and it doesn't matter what we do. You know, God is always there. God is always loving us. And you know, I got so bad, like I said, on the drugs, and you know, I tried taking my life, but God loved me. He said, it's not your time, you know. And you know what happened was because of the drugs and crime, and because of it, I'm in prison 5 times in my life for 5 felony charges of first degree extortion, kidnapping, robbery, heavy body injury, assault, and attempted murder. And I remember the last time in prison, the lawyer saying, hey, Mr. Yamamoto, the state can put you away for life as a career criminal. And I said, career criminal, what is that? He said, well, they're going to sentence you to 40, they're going to put another 40 on top, 80 years. That's the rest of my life in prison. Man, that taught me to be scared. I remember going back to my cell and crying and said, Lord, sorry for the person I became and all the people I hurt. But I said, you know what, Lord, I cannot make it. I cannot make it in here for the rest of my life in this prison. You know, and I said to myself, man, I don't find a way to take my life, you know. A lot of depression, thinking that you in these walls, these inner walls, never to come out again. I felt like Paul the Apostle, you know, where God came and knocked him off his high horse and took away his sight. 3 days, he was so scared he couldn't eat or drink. And the reason why, because he was fighting against God. You know, that's how I felt. I was in this prison cell with 4 inner walls, not being able to see my daughter, my family, friends ever again, thinking that I'd never see them. I got scared, you know, and that drove me. One roommate, God sent an angel, one roommate, to me that was a Christian. He said, hey, Lord, come with me to this Bible study. And I said, you know what, I'll go with you. And they gave me this Bible, and I went to this Bible study with them and walking and carrying this Bible. And all my brothers, you know, and my brothers, you guys all know, when you're in prison, they're all looking at you and your weakness and laughing and say, Roy, what are you doing with that Bible? You know, I said, you know what? You guys can help me. My friends can help me. My family can help me. My lawyer can help me out of this one. You know what? I'm going to see what God can do for me. And I can honestly say I was walking there a little bit ashamed, hiding the Bible, you know, going to the Bible study, man. When we got there, it was so amazing. There was this different spirit on everybody there. They had this different look in their eye, even in prison. And I sat there in my first Bible study, man. Everything that this man started to share was an inmate sharing the Word of God. It started to bring so much comfort to me, you know. And he asked at the end of the Bible study if I wanted to accept Jesus into my life. And I said, yes. And when I say amen to the Lord, it was this uncontrollable tears coming down my eyes. And you know what? It wasn't tears of shame anymore. It was tears of joy. Because, you know, God made me to be a new creation from that day on. And it was so amazing, you know, because the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, any man in Christ is a new creation. The old has gone. And behold, the new has come. When I said amen to the Lord, he made me to be this new creation. And I'm so grateful to God. And you know, we had Bible studies and we all go to the Bible studies. And I take this Bible with me and I sit down. Everybody took turns reading and it came to my turn, man. I was so ashamed. They're telling me to look for this one book and I'm looking for, you know, the books in the Bible and they help me. And then everybody reads and they say, hey, we read verse 3. And I'm looking at them and I'm looking at the book and I'm like, man, where's all the pictures, you know? I don't know how to read, you know? So I looked at them and I started trying to read, but I couldn't even pronounce the word. That's how bad my education was. And man, I felt like, oh man, I'm not gonna learn that. It's not for me, you know? It's like, oh my gosh. But you know, I asked the leader, you think God forgive me for not being able to learn about him? Because you know, I cannot read. How am I learn about him? And you know what happened? The leader said to me, Roy, pray. Nothing is impossible with God. And I remember going back to my cell that day and I kneeled down and placed my hand on the Bible and put my hand on my heart. I said, Jesus, oh my gosh, now I understand I'm one with you. And if I'm one with you, Lord, please teach me to read so I can learn about you. And I tell you, that's the first miracle that ever happened that I knew was from God. God taught me to read like this, and I should read in the Word of God, you know. I can honestly say, you know, when I went, before I went to prison, honestly, I couldn't even read on comic book and understand on comic book. But you know something, Bible says in James, ask anything in my name you give him. You know something, God wanted me to learn about him, who was my creator. You know, so amazing. He taught me to read, and was reading the Word of God. You know, and I started to read, and it was so unbelievable, man. Because before into prison, you know, the Bible says, you know, he gave you eyes to see, ears to hear, and a mind and a heart to conceive the love of God. I never had that. You know, the drugs blind me from seeing God or reaching out for his help. My ears was plugged, you know. And everybody told me, hey, you know, this man can save you, he can help you. But you know what, when you're on drugs, you know, it just blocks it off. But when I received Jesus and the Holy Spirit became one with me, like Revelation says, you know, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and dine with you and eat with me. My gosh, you know, he became one with me, you know, and I started to read, and he started to bring revelation of his word, and I said, wow, it's unbelievable. Next thing you know, I was memorizing chapters in the Bible, you know, and I was thinking to myself, oh my gosh, God made me smart now, you know, it's such a blessing, you know, and it's such a wonderful blessing. But you know what hit me the most? In John 3:3, it says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. And I'm thinking to myself, oh my gosh, you know, it stabbed me so deep in my heart. Because you know what? I was in prison for what my sins deserve, you know. But I said, Lord, but what about my daughter? What about my family and friends and outside? I deserve this, but what about them, Lord? Please give me one more chance to go and share how you changed my life and to share the Lord with them. Because Lord, I want them to be family with me for all eternity. And you know something, God was so good that, man, I prayed every day, God, do this miracle. Your word says in Ephesians that nothing is impossible with you, your God, that you can do, able to do more than anyone can ask. So I said, that's true, Lord. When I go to court, you do this miracle, give me a Christian judge. You know, one day would judge me through the eyes of God, you know. And I went to court and God did this miracle, you know. This judge came out and he said, Mr. Yamamoto, the victim is not here. We're going to drop your charge without prejudice. You can go, you know. And I was like, praise God. I was just, you know, jumping in joy, telling the brothers in the cell, yeah, going home, thank you. Put your trust in God. It's awesome, you know. And went back and I gave away all my belongings when I went back to the prison. And I gave away my shoes, my socks, my shorts, and my Walkman and all my commissary, which is stored, and then you can order food and extra snacks, and gave everything away. I seen the parole board and said, you know what, Roy, you're not getting out, the state appealed your case, you know. I looked at them, I just gave away all my property, you know. And they, you know, they started looking at me, and I said, but you know what, doesn't matter. God wants me to stay in this prison longer so I can learn about him. So when I do get out, I can be the father that he created me to be. I can get out and stay out. So I'm going to stay in here and learn as much. When he's ready, he's going to get the key and open the door for me. And instead of saying pity Roy, I started to get into the word more and more and more and more. I would read from the time I get up till I go sleep. And during our lockdown, I read it. And next thing you know, my Bible used to be like in 100 pages, pieces, because, you know, we were reading or fall asleep and using them as a blanket already, you know, blanket myself with the Word of God. It was so awesome, you know, man. And you know what? Went and seen the judge again, and they dropped my charge again, went back to the prison, and again, this time I walked in there in faith, but I still kept all my store order and never give nothing away. But you know something, I had faith and went down, and guess what, you know, the parole board actually made a mistake. They appealed my case again, but they didn't cut me free, you know. And I called my sister, make sure you're not 1 minute late, they might take me back, give the front gate, you know. And my sister came and she picked me up, and I told her, walk straight for the car, no, turn around, hurry up, you know. And we went, and you know, God spoke to me and said, Roy, it's important for you to keep me as close as the clothes that you wear on your body. you know. And I promised him I'll go to the first church I find when I get out of prison, Anchorage Church. And I remember getting out there and going to this church. I was sitting laying out back with my cousin. And this guy comes up and he starts sharing his testimony on stage. I'm looking at him, he looks so familiar. And this is how God answered prayers. The guy says his name, Jazhang Wenanghu. I realized I was a judge who would cut me free from living life in prison, you know? I ran down from the back after and he was up here and I ran down and I was going to shake his hand like this and I said, he was my judge, you know, and he would look at me, how much time I gave this big guy, you know, and, like, and then after that, oh, I started crying and crying and I just took his hand and said, thank you so much, you know, it's because of your decision, I get to be out here worshiping God, you know, and I, God answered my prayer today because I was praying from Christian judge, and you know something, God is so good. He answered my prayer. And he started bawling and crying. I'm looking at this judge. What are you crying about? You know, you're thanking me. I said, what are you thanking me for? You're a judge, you know? And he said, no. You don't know, Roy. I became a Christian right before you went to court. And he said, thank you for praying for me, you know? And God is so good. From that time, God really blessed my life. He brought my daughter back in my life after 13 years. And, you know, I started serving God, became good friends with this judge, and started ministry, and you know, state appealed my case again 2 years later, and it was like, oh my gosh, you know. And I said, Lord, I just give it to you, and whatever, you know. But, you know, God answered my prayer. I got to lead my daughter to the Lord, and my, a lot of my family, my friends, I said to the Lord, no matter what, I don't care. I'll serve God with a happy heart in prison for the rest of my life. All the prison doesn't matter anymore. Amen. My family will be family for all eternity. You know? And I said, that's all matters. And, you know, God is such a precious God that, you know, I went and plead guilty to the point because they said if I fought it and lost it, they'd give me life. So I said, you know what, I plead guilty. Went in for my sentencing, God would show up in such a mighty way. So much people that came and supported me with angels from God, and judge came out and said, you see, this first judge couldn't be my judge. I prayed for another Christian judge because we were friends, you know. So I went and I went in there and he said, you know, you have a lot of support, it's good, but your co-defendant just got sentenced to the same spot where you're standing today to 20 years, and I'm a judge that believe in equal justice. But this judge looks up to me and he said, you know what, Roy, I know that God did change your life, you know. So instead of sentencing you today, I will cut you free and give you back your freedom. And God allowed me to be out. And this judge could be one judge right after that, the first one, and became my executive pastor at a church, you know? And he was my boss like this past 14 years, you know? What a blessing. And then, you know, they hired me to be a prison chaplain right after that. And it was such a blessing, you know, just so humbled to be used by God. I love the Lord so much, and God bless me, you know. I got to start in the ministry, and I didn't know how to do anything. In the third grade, I come in and trying to run a ministry, but you know what, like Paul says, you know, he do ministry in fear, because it's not, it's for the power of God to be, not glory to us, but him. He can do that to anybody, to any one of us, and it was such a blessing. And you know, we got to start ministry and God, you continue walking with the Lord, you can give you divine favor. He's such an awesome God. And the Bible talks about how we overcome Satan is by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And continue walking in that. It's so such a blessing. I go to the sister church and share, and this guy comes out and he said hi to me. I walk away, we're down the road, and I turn around and be like, you judge Michael Town? He said, yes. Oh, you're my second, you know, I just talked about you in the first service over here. He came in this church and he got so blessed. We've been partnering together and doing this. It's going to be our 8th Camp Agape that we're going to do this year. And God put in our heart to start this ministry called Camp Agape, which is agape, is God's love, his unconditional love. And he said to go make this camp for the children and let them know at the foot of the cross is level ground. You know, that come all. And, you know, he put in my heart that Hebrews 13:3 about remember the prisoners as you, your fellow prisoners, if you're chained with them. And remember those who are mistreated if you yourself are suffering. And God put in my heart to draw a hand for the children of incarcerated, because I know it was how it was when I was locked up and the gift that God gave me. So we started this ministry called Camp Agape. And we usually take 150 children every single year to this camp and make provide free for the Lord. Everything is free for them. But you know, it's such a blessing because almost every camp that we did, almost 100% of the children that come for the first time receive Jesus into their lives, the Lord and Savior. And it's such a blessing. And you know, I tell you, we've seen that God did a miracle. We had children in our camp came to the first one, and they've been with us for 8 years now as junior mentors and giving back. And the Bible says, as I come to you, come to the others. They've been such a blessing to the rest of the children. And Pastor Kip, if you know my imam, one of my brothers was in prison of Sabar, wanted to come up and read something real fast. Yeah. I was at the Straight Up conference on Friday, and I seen this man and had this big glow on his face, and he had this, such a smile, and he came running up to me and hugging me, and he said, "How was in Sabar prison?" Well, we've been going up and doing revivals and outreaches up there. And last time we went, the first time we went, 750 men accepted the Lord, and we did many outreaches there. And it's such a blessing to go back where we came from. And we met my brother this last time in a faithful worshiping God, and we know that he is going to be an anointed man by God.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Father's Day to all the dads. My name is Gary. I just got home. I was in Sagura for 5 years. I just want to share something that during my time there, I've been in a faith board and I wrote, doing to journaling and stuff. So I just want to share a little. There are times when the quietness of our everyday actions speaks loudly, revealing our love for the Lord. In our desires to share Christ with a broken world that is out of touch with Jesus. The Bible gives us all we need to live our life for each day. But it won't help if we don't read and practice what His pages say. God can transform our brokenness so that our lives can function in the right direction. As we turn our eyes to the Lord in times of pain and struggle, we will experience His comfort and hope in our daily lives. He will help us. Keep your eyes upon Jesus, focusing on Christ, put everything in perspective. By grace we are saved. Grace is an important part in our lives. To change can be a wonderful prospect. The transformation begins within us. And will take a lot of persistence. It's a lesson some of us have to learn over and over. We can change others, but with God's help, we can change our own behavior. And when our attitude changes, it may seem as if others as well. When God works a change in us, He can change others through us. Then you will know that the humble spirit is within you. Amen. For we walk by faith, not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5:7. I rather walk in the dark with God, then go alone in the light. Walk by faith with Him, then go alone by sight. All I can say is Jesus is the answer for the world today. Our challenge is to avoid the mistake of the sheep who blindly followed one another over the cliff. So the big question is, whom are we following? One another, self-centered shepherd, or the voice and direction of the Good Shepherd? We all face a choice. Have you made the decision to trust God? We are not equipped to handle the problems we face, but God is. Because unemployment, poverty, and malnutrition are serious problems, the people often don't know where the next meal will come from. So each time they sit down to eat, they thank God and ask Him to provide the next meal. Amen. Thank you.
Such a blessing. You know, we've been going up there and teaching a man how to journal and get in the Word of God. And, you know, as shepherds and people that go into prison, you know, we can be there once a week or go up there once in a while, but our main thing in the camps and when we do prison outreach is to go up there and to teach them how to get in the Word of God and do their devotion. So when we leave, they learn how to feed themselves and they become this man and children of God. And the Bible says if you get the Word of God and plant it into a good soil, you have 100 times more than you ever had. So praise God. And you know, we're going to call out the children from our camps or junior mentors that come out here and our men in our ministry. And we're going to dance this dance for you called I Follow Christ. And on this Father's Day, our biggest prayer for every one of us and you folks is that you join us in this commitment as we choose to follow Christ. It's such a blessing. And you know what? It took us going in prison to receive Jesus, but it became the biggest and greatest thing in the whole world. And we're so great. And we're going to dance this dance, and I'm going to tell you something. We're not good dancers, but I tell you something. Me, my brothers, and the children, you know, the Bible says God looked to and fro for the hearts are totally abandoned for Him. We do this because we love Jesus, and because He saved us, there's nothing that we wouldn't do for Him. So we're going to dance and dance for you. Give us grace, but we love Jesus.
I will.
Can we give them another just a round of applause? Thank you so much. To hear from Pastor Roy, you know, I think there are a few things that he may not have mentioned that they're doing and impacting the world. They are doing just an amazing work. They have a ministry called Agape Christian Fellowship. Is that correct, Pastor? And what they do is they partner with other churches, or other churches partner with them, and we are going to be one of these partnering churches that help them with Camp Agape. Help them with, and Camp Agape are all the children of the incarcerated, like Pastor Roy was saying. So everybody who is inside, if they have kids who go to our own schools, maybe they feel out of place because, oh, mom's in jail, dad's in jail, etc. And so we take care of them. We have the opportunity to take care of them. So we're in talking, and we want to be able to partner with Pastor Roy and their ministry. You know, maybe 2 years ago, I remember I was in Pastor Roy's office, and we were sitting down, and I said, oh, Pastor Roy, what you're doing is amazing. If the Lord ever, you know, allows us to build this church, we want to partner with you folks. And here we are. We are here. We are absolutely here. And so we want to be able to partner with them. And, you know, we always say this, that it's important to remember that there are two kinds of people. There are critics, and there are surgeons. When something happens, a critic will always say, well, see what happens? And that's what happens when you do stuff like that, right? We say, hey, we want to be able to help people who have families or who are incarcerated, etc. We want to be able to help them. But a critic will say, well, they shouldn't have did that then. You know, they should just obey the law and they wouldn't end up in jail. So, you know, they should just do the right thing. And those are critics. But surgeons, they just come in and they just do the job. If somebody gets shot on the road and they come into a surgeon, the surgeon just wants to take the bullet out of the person. That's all the concern. They don't say, well, you know, if you wasn't at the neighborhood over there, you probably wouldn't have been driving by, then you wouldn't have got shot. See what happens. And that's what critics do. We want to be those people who are like surgeons and just see the need. And if we are able to help out, let's help out. We don't usually take two offerings in a service, but today we want to be able to do that. So our ushers are going to be passing out envelopes for you folks. Can we just give envelopes to everybody? And even if you don't feel led to give, no problem. Could I ask you to do this though? Would you just write Pastor Roy something on that envelope? You know, the encouragement that you folks give and that we give as a church, at the end of this, you know, I'll meet with Pastor Roy, and we'll talk, and I'll tell him how much I love him and remind him how much he's loved and all of our friendship and relationship. But there's a difference when he can hear from you as well. So what I want to ask you to do, worship team, if we could come up, please, and be prepared to lead us through one more worship song. And everyone here, just take an envelope, write something to Pastor Roy and to their ministry, and then let's give. Let's help them out. Let's help this ministry. Let's help them grow. Let's partner with them. In the future, I do believe that we will possibly have a Camp Agape here in Maui. Is that correct, Pastor? And if we do, and when that comes to fruition, perhaps some of us could volunteer and help out. We could go and get trained, and so that when we do have the camp, we could serve people well. That's really what we want to do. And again, I just want to say thank you again, Pastor Roy, and your heart. You know, what we tell everybody here is when people come and when they minister, to always be looking for the spirit of the person, you know, and the spirit of the Lord is just upon him. So at this time, let's pray over this offering, and as you're filling it out or writing a letter, etc., our worship team is going to lead us, but let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to give to this ministry, Lord. What a wonderful work they are doing. We thank you so much for this opportunity, Lord, to just partner with them. We pray that every single bit of finances or even prayers or blessings that we send to Pastor Roy, Father, that you and your hand may be upon it. That you would allow them to continue to touch others in the name of Jesus Christ and bring more people to the revelation, salvation knowledge of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give. Yeah.